significant moment that we commemorate. I just want to pass on that we're not attending a funeral service this morning. We're commemorating that which God, through Jesus Christ, has done many years ago to secure our eternal salvation. So as we go through this service, I want us to be in an attitude of reflection on that which God has done, and that we be reminded of the cost and the value of our eternal salvation. And in that spirit, we welcome you to this Good Friday service, and we pray that God's Spirit may so inspire your soul that at the end of the service, you would have said, "It is good to have been here." The service will take the form of reflecting on God's Word. So we'll be having readings going through. As these scriptures are being read, I encourage you to keep your hearts centered and your minds focused on God and the work He has done. So whatever burdens and troubles you have, leave them at the door, leave them at your feet, and cast your cares and your mind and your attention on God. I believe with the opening reading from the Gospel according to St. John, chapter 1, verses 1 through 14. And as I read, we'll have the lighting of the six candles, including the Christ candle. St. John, chapter 1, verses 1 through 14. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through Him, and without Him nothing was made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. This man came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light which gives light to every man who comes into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own did not receive him. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, even to those who believe in his name. Who were born not of blood, nor of the will of flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of God, full of grace and truth. This is the Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We wanted the response on your programs. What happened? Why are you here?
We have come because they have crucified our Lord.
Who has crucified our Lord? I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus. Jesus, Lord. We will sing the song Servant King. From Help You Came, Help You Stayed. Enter the world, your glory to be. Not to be served, but to serve. And to give your life, that you may my peace. After we will join in the prayer of adoration and
place in the heavens knows us intimately.
even the secret sins of our lives are in the light of your countenance. Where shall we flee from your presence, or where shall we go? For if we ascend to the heavens, you are there. And if we were to take the wings of the morning and dwell in the utmost parts of the sea, even there your right hand would uphold us. Heavenly Father, in you we live and move and have all being. We live in your inescapable presence. Your power and your might are awesome, and we can only live in awe of your wonder. Heavenly Father, you speak and the creation responds to you. Your words, Heavenly Father, are eternal. Your words are short. When you speak, Heavenly Father, your word does not come back to you void. But even as the rain waters the soil and causes seed to send down root and send up shoots and give up fruit, even so, your word does not come back to you void. Your word stands sure, and your word is from everlasting to everlasting. Heavenly Father, your thoughts are not like our thoughts, and your ways are not like our ways. Even as the heaven is high above the earth, so are your thoughts above our thoughts, and your ways above our ways. We stand in awe of your majesty. We stand in awe of your might. We stand in awe of who you are, and we just live in your fear. Heavenly Father, who are we that you even take thought of us, the sons of men, that you even visit us? For you have created us even lower than the angels, but you have crowned us with your glory and with honor. Father, we are eternally grateful and thankful that you care enough for us, lost in our sins, dead in our trespasses, that you would have come down to secure our eternal salvation. That which would have bring us back to oneness with you. That we may be seen as justified in your sight, in your eyes, to receive right relationship, a renewed relationship with you, that we might enjoy the inheritance from before the foundations of the earth. Heavenly Father, words cannot suffice for us to express how eternally grateful we are for your work of salvation that you have brought, and that you have brought to effect through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have made a way available for us to escape the corruption of the flesh in death. That you have secured for us the way of life. Not just for this life, but for now and eternity. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are our keeper, and that which we have committed to you, you're able to keep and to enable us to perform until the last day. Father, we confess that we have not been faithful as we ought to have been. We have not been persevering as much as we should have. We have complained, Heavenly Father, when we should have borne with dignity. Father, we confess that we have not been as kind to our neighbors as we should have been. We confess, Heavenly Father, that we have treated your salvation lightly. We confess that we have not taken seriously the work that you have done to secure the salvation of our souls. We confess, Heavenly Father, that we have treated your Son with disdain. We confess that we have not owned and represented your Son in the way that we ought to, as much as we should. We confess, Heavenly Father, that we need your help in order to do that which you have called us to. We confess, Heavenly Father, we have tried to do work in our own strength rather than relying on you. Father, we confess that we have not trusted in you as much as we should have. We confess that we have leaned more to our own understanding at times rather than trusting in you all of our heart. Father, we confess that we have sinned in areas that we know better. We confess, Heavenly Father, that we have given in when we should have held on. We confess, Heavenly Father, that we have not focused on you as much as we have focused on our prophets. We confess, Heavenly Father, that you are the only one who can cleanse us from all sin and secure our eternal salvation. Father, we confess our sins and our shortcomings to you even now, knowing that you are faithful, you will never break your promise, that you are faithful and you are just, that if we confess our sins, you are faithful and you are just to forgive us, and not just to forgive us, but to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And we receive that cleansing from unrighteousness even now through the blood of Jesus Christ, whose work we commemorate this day. So, Heavenly Father, grant us your peace, the peace that comes from the passion of Christ. Your peace which passes all understanding, the kind of peace that speaks of atonement, at one mate with you. We pray that we will experience that peace in right relationship with you, that we come to you not just a form of godliness, but with a contrite heart that seeks you and seeks right relationship with you. So hear our prayers now, we pray, Heavenly Father, and may your Holy Spirit move among us, come alive in us, and cause our minds and our hearts to come alive in you, that our spirits might be renewed, and that our relationship might be reconnected and renewed in you. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for hearing our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
We will repeat the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Christ, the Lamb of God. Your only Son no sin to hide, but you have sent him from your side to walk upon this guilty soil and to become the Lamb of God. Shall we rise and sing?
Thank you.
constantly. The peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us worship the Lord. I'll invite the praise team to lead us in the singing of the song.
Thank you.
Brothers and sisters, as we reflect on the work of salvation that God has done, I just want to take just a couple of seconds to introduce us to a passage of scripture, Isaiah 53, which assures us that our salvation was not an afterthought by God. And let me tell you something about your salvation, sisters and brothers, on this Good Friday. People can manufacture facts, they can't manufacture history. Are you with me?
Yes.
Say anything you want about alternative facts, but you can't manufacture history. Yes. Now, Isaiah 53 is just going to form the base Old Testament text from which the readings will be taking place. Outlines, actually, the whole experience of the Messiah going through his selection, his rejection, the work he has done. It goes into so much details that even in Isaiah 53 talks about him being killed, not just that, but that he'll be numbered among transgressors. And not just that, in the last verse, Isaiah 53 says, he will intercession for the transgressors. And that was his last word of cross. So the point I'm trying to get across to us is that, and it was said last week, grace was freely given, but it came at a cost.
Yes.
And our reflection this morning is a reminder for reminding ourselves of the cost and the value of that which we have, the salvation from God. And Isaiah 53 talks about the Messiah being rejected. It talks about us being as lost sheep, gone in our own way, and how God laid on him the iniquity of us all. How he was rejected, how he was tried, I did not even say a word. It's not because Jesus didn't have words to say, but as a sheep, I was led to share wisdom. He opened up his soul. So that we can have a voice. Isn't that great?
Amen.
Hallelujah. He remained silent so that we can have a voice. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. So we will be going through a number of readings, and the first reading will focus on the Messiah being despised and rejected by his sheep. The readings will be taken from Isaiah chapter 53, verses 2 and 3, and the corresponding reading, Matthew chapter 27, verses 11 to the 31. And we'll be asking Sister Sharon Edwards.
Isaiah 53, verses 2 to 3, as we read it from the Message paraphrase. The servant grew up before God, a scrawny seedling, a scrubby plant in a parched field. There was nothing attractive about him, nothing to cause us to take a second look. He was looked down on and passed over, a man who suffered, who knew pain firsthand. One look at him and people turned away. We looked down on him, thought he was scoffed. The second reading will be taken from Matthew chapter 27, verses 11 to 31. And I will be reading from the New Living Translation. Now Jesus was standing before Pilate, the Roman governor. "Are you the king of the Jews?" the governor asked him. Jesus replied, "You have said it." But when the leading priests and the elders made their accusations against him, Jesus remained silent. "Don't you hear all these charges they are bringing against you?" Pilate demanded. But Jesus made no response to any of the charges, much to the governor's surprise. Now, it was the governor's custom each year during the Passover celebration to release one prisoner to the crowd, anyone they wanted. This year, there was a notorious prisoner, a man named Barabbas. As the crowds gathered before Pilate's house that morning, he asked them, "Which one do you want me to release to you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" He knew very well that the religious leaders had arrested Jesus out of envy. Just then, as Pilate was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent him this message: "Leave that innocent man alone. I suffered through a terrible nightmare about him last night." Meanwhile, the leading priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas to be released and for Jesus to be put to death. So the governor asked again, "Which of these two do you want me to release to you?" The crowd shouted, "Barabbas!" Pilate responded, "Then what should I do with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" They shouted back, "Crucify him!" "Why?" Pilate demanded. "What crime has he committed?" But the mob roared even louder, "Crucify him!" Pilate saw that he wasn't getting anywhere and that a riot was developing. So he sent for a bowl of water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying, "I am innocent of this man's blood. The responsibility is yours." And all the people yelled back, "We will take responsibility for his death, we and our children." So Pilate released Barabbas to them. He ordered Jesus flogged with a lead-tipped whip, then turned him over to the Roman soldiers to be crucified. This is the word of the Lord.
Let's remain seated as we reflect. We sing a song, "Man of Sorrows." Let's reflect silently on the passion of Christ. stricken and forsaken by God the Shepherd. This reading will come to us from Isaiah chapter 53, verses 4, 6, and 10. And the New Testament corresponding reading will come from the Gospel according to Mark chapter 14, verses 32 to 41, and Matthew chapter 27, verses 45 to 46. And we ask Krishna to pray.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Where are we today? Sorry?
Yes.
Good, yes, no, maybe so.
Alright.
The first lesson will be coming from Isaiah 53, 3, 4, 6, and 10. And it says, surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. The next reading will be taken from Mark 14, 32 to 41. And then they came to a place which was named Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, sit ye here while I pray. And he hath taken with him Peter, James, and John, and began to be sore amazed and to be very heavy. And he said unto them, my soul is exceeding sorrowful unto death. Tarry ye here and watch. And he went forward a little, and fell on the ground, and prayed that, if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. And he said, Abba, Father, all things are possible unto thee. Take away this cup from me. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what thou wilt. And he cometh, and findeth them sleeping, and said unto Peter, Simon, said unto Peter, Simon, sleepest thou? Couldest thou not watch 1 hour? Watch ye and pray, lest ye enter into temptation. The spirit truly is ready, but the flesh is weak. And again he went away, and prayed, and spake the same words. And when he returned, he found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy. Neither wist they what to answer him. And he cometh the third time, and said unto them, sleep on now, and take your rest. It is enough, the hour is come. Behold, the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. The last reading will be taken from Mark 14. Matthew 27, 45 to 46. Now the sixth hour there was darkness all over all the land unto the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? That is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Here endeth another portion of reading.
And we rise for the singing of the hymn, How Deep the Father's Love for Us.
Thank you.
those of us who have our programs, you would recognize that after side reflection, we extinct the candles. I never have to go to the table. Hallelujah. Never have to go. Let's just reflect on the awesome, wonderful. Hallelujah. Smitten, afflicted, pierced. As we reflect on our Savior and work of his salvation, we are reading from Isaiah chapter 53, verse 5, and the corresponding New Testament reading from the Gospel according to Mark chapter 15, verses 1 through to 3. We'll ask Mark.
Smitten, afflicted, pierced. Isaiah 53, verse 5. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. Mark 15, 1 to 20. Jesus before Pilate. Very early in the morning, the chief priests with the elders, the teachers of the law, and the whole Sanhedrin reached a decision. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Are you the king of the Jews? Asked Pilate. Yes, it is as you say, Jesus replied. The chief priests accused him of many things. So again, Pilate asked him, aren't you going to answer? See how many things they are accusing you of? But Jesus still made no reply, and Pilate was amazed. Now it was the custom at the feast to release a prisoner whom the people requested. A man called Barabbas was in prison with the insurrectionists who had committed murder in the uprising. The crowd came up and asked Pilate to do for them what he usually did. Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews? Asked Pilate, knowing that it was out of envy that the chief priests had handed Jesus over to him. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have Pilate release Barabbas instead. What shall I do then with the one you call the king of the Jews? Pilate asked him. Crucify him, they shouted. Why? What crime has he committed? Asked Pilate. But they shouted all louder. Crucify him! Wanting to satisfy the crowd, Pilate released Barabbas to them. He had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified. The soldiers led Jesus away into the palace and called together the whole company of soldiers. They put a purple robe on him, then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on him. And they began to call out to him, Hail, King of the Jews! Again and again they struck him on the head with a staff and spit on him. Falling on their knees, they paid homage to him. And when they had mocked him, they took off the purple robe and put his old clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. This is the word of the Lord.
Let's remain seated as we join in the singing of the hymn, O Sacred Head. Now we will.
Thank you.
for the next 60 seconds, I won't disturb or disrupt your meditation. And you should never leave the same. Like the lamb to the slaughter. Reading from Isaiah 53, verse 7, and the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 24, verses 26 to 46. We'll be asking the Kimberly.
He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. Luke 24:26-46. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. And they drew nigh unto the village, whither they went, and he made as though he would have gone further. But they constrained him, saying, Abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. And he went in to tarry with them. And it came to pass, as he sat at meat with them, he took bread, and blessed it, and brake, and gave to them. And their eyes were opened, and they knew him, and he vanished out of their sight. And they said one to another, Did not our heart burn within us, while he talked with us by the way, and while he opened to us the scriptures? And they rose up the same hour, and returned to Jerusalem, and found the 11 gathered together, and them that were with them, saying, The Lord is risen indeed, and hath appeared to Simon. And they told what things were done in the way, and how he was known of them in breaking of bread. And as they thus spake, Jesus himself stood in the midst of them, and saith unto them, Peace be unto you. But they were terrified and affrighted, and supposed that they had seen a spirit. And he said unto them, Why are you troubled, and why do thoughts arise in your hearts? Behold my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Handle me and see, for a spirit hath not flesh and bones, as ye see me have. And when he had thus spoken, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they yet believed not for joy, and wondered, he said unto them, Have ye here any meat? And they gave him a piece of broiled fish, and of an honeycomb. And he took it, and did eat before them. And he said unto them, These are the words which I spake unto you, while I was yet with you, that all the things must be fulfilled, which were written in the law of Moses, and in the prophets, and in the Psalms, concerning me. Then opened he their understanding, that they might understand the scriptures, said unto them, Thus it is written, and thus did behold Christ to suffer, and to rise from the dead the third day. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. into a nameless grave. Readings from the prophet Isaiah chapter 53, verses 8 and 9, and from the Gospel according to St. John chapter 19, verses 31 to 42. This will be read by Father Leo.
Greet you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'll be reading Isaiah 53, 8 to 9 from the Amplified Version. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, and for his generation, who among them considered that he was far? Out of the land of the living, stricken to his death. For the transgression of my Isaiah's people, to whom the was good, and they assigned him a grave with the wicked, and with a rich man in his death. Although he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his body. Second reading, New Testament reading, a deadly account, an unprecedented account, but from the living Bible. The Jewish leaders didn't want the victims anger the next day, which was the Sabbath, and a very special Sabbath at that. For it was the Passover, so they asked Pilate to order the legs of the men broken to hasten death. Then their bodies would be taken. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the two men crucified with Jesus. But when they came to him, they saw that he was dead already. So they didn't break it. However, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and blood and water flowed out. I saw all this myself, and I've given an account, an accurate one, so that you also can believe. The soldiers did this in fulfillment of the scripture that says, not one bone of his broken body, but not one of his bones shall be broken. And they shall look on him whom they pierced. Afterwards, Joseph of Arimathea, who had been a secret disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jewish leaders, boldly asked Pilate for permission to take Jesus' body down. And Pilate told him to go ahead. So he came and took it away. Nicodemus, the man who had come to Jesus at night, came too, bringing 100 pounds of embalming ointment made from myrrh and aloes. Together they wrapped Jesus' body in long linen cloth, saturated with spices, as is the Jewish custom of burial. The place of crucifixion was near a grove of trees, where there was a nook or two, never used before. And so, because of the need for haste before the Sabbath, and because the tomb was close at hand, they made him there. This is the word of the Lord.
He rises and rejoins the saying of the hymn, beneath the cross.
Thank you.
And so, Lord, as we reflect on your meal here and on your shed love on Calvary, as we reflect on how you were rejected by men, born slain, accused, put to death, despised, shamed. As we reflect on all that you have done to secure our eternal salvation, as we reflect, Heavenly Father, may you, by the power of your Holy Spirit, remind us that your salvation is without repentance, that you do not change your mind about offering us your salvation freely. That you remind us, Heavenly Father, that our salvation is of priceless value. That we be reminded that we are bought with that price, the price of the blood of your Son. That we will always remember not just the price, but the value. That nothing can supersede it in value. And that we will hold this treasure in our earthen container with great fervor. That we will guard the salvation of our souls. That we will be mindful to share the message of your salvation with the dying world. That we will not just hear, but that your word and the meaning of the message of your salvation will penetrate our hearts and our souls, our minds. That our wills might be inclined to you, even as you submitted your will to the will of the Father. Oh Lord, to see you as you are, we reflect on your work in the country, and we pray to the Father that the power and the impact of that work might be made manifest in our lives, that we will walk around as new reborn creatures, not as ex-sinners, but as saints justified by grace, justified by the extension of God's grace to the Lord Jesus. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for showing mercy to us while we were yet dead in our trespasses and sins. Thank you for your time of salvation. Thank you for Calvary. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for providing for the salvation also, that we might live and experience life for them. Thank you for the presence and power of the Holy Spirit in us. And as we proceed to the rest of the service, we pray to the Father that you would reassure us and comfort us and be among us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Suffering in the presence of enemies. This reading will come to us from Psalm 23, and after this reading, of course, our Reverend Philip Ellis will come with a message reflection for the morning. But this reading will also be done by Reverend Philip Ellis. So I invite him now.
The Lord is
is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table for me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. Throughout this service, so far, we have tried by sight, song, covered up with music and singing, and a period of silence, years of silence, to get us back to identify with the shepherd, to identify with Jesus the shepherd, who becomes a lamb through the crucifixion and through the experience of Calvary. And so we have been taking you through those steps, walking you through those stages of the journey, linking our affections to the Isaiah passage of the suffering servant, helping us to make connection with the servant and understanding the message of that particular passage. As we continue our reflection, I want us to reflect with me or pause and look with me on verse 5 of Psalm 23, part of verse 5. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Focus on the second part of verse 5, in the presence of my enemies. As we would have seen in the order of service, suffering in the presence of enemies. And as I indicated, we have been looking at the shepherd, the one who loves, the one who leads, the one who lavishes gifts on the sheep. Because a good shepherd is one who makes sure that the sheep are well fed. And David himself was a shepherd. So when David wrote this psalm, David knew what the life of a shepherd was. He was not someone who was writing about a shepherd or writing about the work of a shepherd from a remote, distant perspective. He was writing as a shepherd because he himself was a shepherd. The wholeness and welfare and security of the shepherd, of the sheep, is dependent on the skill and wisdom and insight and attentiveness of the shepherd. The shepherd must be able to smell danger. The shepherd must be able to sense where there is healthy grass for the sheep to eat. The shepherd must know which sheep are his, so that he leads the sheep appropriately. In the case of Jesus, who becomes the shepherd, who becomes the lamb, we're reminded that his life was not taken from him. It was not robbed from him. He is the good shepherd who gives his life for his sheep. What a thought. What a reality. that the shepherd, out of his own concern and compassion for the sheep, offers his life for the sheep freely. That is what the shepherd does. The shepherd is prepared to lay down his life for the sheep. Of course, like Jesus said, you know, when it is a hired hand, and the hired hand sees the enemy coming, the hired hand abandons the sheep and runs for his life. But not so with the shepherd. The shepherd is prepared to ward off all the attackers because the sheep are precious. They are seen on the shepherd transitions from being a shepherd to a sheep. Like a lamb before his shearers, he opened not his mouth. In this case, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world, was not dumb. He could have called 10,000 angels. That would have been easy, but it would not have been the right thing to do. Are you with me? He could have called 10,000 angels, easy, but not the plan. The plan and purpose of God would not have been achieved in this way. So we have gone through Isaiah 53, the suffering servant, and observed how Jesus assumed the role of the servant in the New Testament. It is not clear sometimes who the servant is in that book. The servant is typified as Israel. Israel is the servant. Sometimes the writer uses the king, like Cyrus. However, it is commonly held, even as Israel being the servant, that the servant executes the mind, the will, and the purpose of God. Jesus is presented then as God's servant, God's shepherd, God's lamb. The psalmist picks up the theme of the shepherd in the presence of his enemies. And we get a glimpse of the role of God the Father, the action of the enemies, and the response of the shepherd. His actions all conspire to give us some insights on Jesus' action as a model for us in how to respond in the midst of suffering. I know, my brothers and sisters, that it may be a little difficult for us sometimes in a worship service of this nature to be able to grasp all of the components, all the different experiences and expressions of journey with Jesus. But remember, we are journeying with Jesus, who went through different stages from the Garden of Gethsemane, even before, right up to his death on the cross. We are going through the stages of the cross, and so those periods of silence that we go through are times when we are identifying with Christ. I know that it is difficult to create this kind of solemnity in a world where people don't reverence anything holy anymore. When somebody is dying, or when somebody is being attacked, or when somebody is being stabbed, or when somebody is being killed, people take their cameras and take a picture and then send it or share it with others on social media. People are not reverent anymore. People don't pause and say, "How could you do that?" It is a photo opportunity. This is the world in which we live. So when I invite you to journey with me, journey with Jesus, take those spaces where you pause, where you remain silent, where you listen to Jesus, where you analyze with him, and you wonder what is it that was going through his mind when he was brought before the high priest, when he was brought before Herod, when he was brought before Pilate. What was going through his mind when he was mocked by the soldiers? What was going through his mind when the common thief challenged him on the cross? What was going through his mind when he said, "Father, forgive them"? What was going through Jesus' mind? It's your opportunity to journey with Jesus. I want us to be engaged in the presence of my enemies, to listen to the psalmist as the psalmist focuses on the action of God in the presence of my enemies. According to the psalmist, it is the Lord who prepares a table in the presence of all his enemies. It is God who makes that preparation. Let us not miss this. Because if we miss this, we lose sight of the whole Easter, Good Friday experience. It is God. It is God the Father
who makes preparation, who prepares this table in the presence of my enemies.
The declaration is that, sorry, God is opposed. God is in charge. God is at the controls.
God it is who makes the preparation for the servant.
And in this, we see prepares a table in the presence of my enemies. We see God's goodness. All of the journey of Good Friday reflects the goodness of God. How God good so? How God stays so good? How God could reach out the way he did through Good Friday experience? We see the generosity of God. He spared nothing. He presents a feast in the presence of my enemies. What is this feast? I wanted to engage your mind in that, what this feast is all about. But he presents that feast in the presence of my enemies.
One who prepares a feast is usually a host.
One who prepares a feast is usually hospitable. One who prepares a feast is usually one who invites you to partake, who invites you to participate, who is saying to you, here is the feast. You can participate in this feast because it is prepared for you. And the psalmist is telling us that he prepares a table before me in the presence of my enemies. It is God who makes that preparation. The act conveys neighborliness or kindness of God, or kindness on the part of God. To prepare a table suggests kindness and hospitality. God is the host and the servant is the guest. We should know that this psalm was not directly referring to Jesus, but when applied to the experience of the crucifixion on the cross, you get the picture that God has a master plan. What is the master plan that God could have that he prepares a table before or in the presence of his enemies? As the author of Proverbs states, he invited me to his banqueting hall and his banner over me is love. It is God who creates this table, who hosts this event, knowing that there are enemies who want to eat of the flesh of Jesus. His very action confuses and confounds the enemy. The enemy is preparing for a war when he lays out a table. The enemy does not understand. The enemy is preparing for war. But while the enemy is considering that they are engaged in crucifying Jesus, they don't understand that Jesus is preparing a table before all his enemies. That's what Jesus was doing. That's what God was doing. That's what the Father was doing. But the enemy was seeing an occasion for them to crucify Jesus.
The enemy was preparing for war. Jesus lays out, the Father lays out the table. They are preparing for confrontation and conflict. God is preparing for liberation and redemption. Yes.
It's a table not marked by hostility, but by hospitality and kindness. It's a table that is always opposite to that of the enemy. It confounds and confuses the wise. That is how God acts.
The cross does not look like a table, but it is God's means of showing love and compassion. Are you with me?
Yes.
There is nothing about the cross that looks like a table that God spread before his enemies. There's nothing about that table. There's nothing about that experience that says this is a table.
That is what God spreads before his enemies.
That is what God spreads right there.
Showing love and compassion to an estranged world.
You may ask, why did Christ have to die? Couldn't there have been another way? The cross seemed so cruel and mean.
Yet it was in the plan of God.
It was the means by which sinful humanity would be reconciled to God. Jesus is described as love who takes away the sin of the world. John 1:29. Sin entered God's perfect world through the first man, Adam, and this led to separation from God. This was a perfect world, a world where there's harmony between God and humanity, a world where there's perfect harmony between God and nature, a world where there was perfect harmony between God and all created beings. That harmony was disturbed by disobedience, by sin. Sin entered into the world and destroyed that harmony. Listen to what the evil one said to Adam, the first man. Did God really say, he said it first to Eve, did God say you shall die? Even though God said the soul, that when you eat from this tree, you shall surely die. Place doubt in the mind of Eve. Did God say you shall surely die? And with sin entering the world, that separated the relationship between God and humanity. That harmonious experience was changed into hostility. That harmonious experience was changed into confrontation and conflict. That harmonious experience was changed into enmity. God had to find a way. And the only way was through perfect man and perfect God, Jesus Christ. He became the sacrifice. He became the lamb sacrificed for our sins. It was through the blood of Jesus Christ, who was fully man and fully God, that mankind's sin could be atoned before God, that man could be reconciled, that mankind could be at one with God again, that there would be the possibility for all humanity to have peace with God once more. My brothers and sisters, is that a peace that we desire in our own lives? Is that a peace that we recognize maybe missing from our lives and we desire to experience? That is what is offered through Jesus Christ. God knew the pain. This is God's grace at work. God is not giving up on us. Our God is not giving us what we deserve. God goes beyond giving what we deserve and goes beyond and says, this you don't deserve it, but I'm offering it to you. It is free for us. It is free for us. But we know, and we are journeying with Jesus. So we are back to God as host who spreads a table for all the enemy to see. It's a table for the servant, but one which would make the enemies believe that they are leading or gaining ground, only to discover that God has the last words. That is why there are some commentators or some writers who believe that God tricked the devil, making the devil think that he had the last word, that he had victory in the death of Jesus Christ, and the trick came when Jesus rose from the dead. That is the perception. God is not offering any trick here. It is God's plan. God is God, and God has a final word on human's life. It doesn't matter how far you go. It doesn't matter how wild you become. It doesn't matter where you are. It is God who has the final word. There's a sense in which this table that is spread is a defiance and a derision to the enemies. It defies enemy lines. It defies enemy intention. It defies enemy action. It's a derision of what the enemies can do. Look at you. I am putting a table right before you. What are you going to do about it? How are you going to change it? That's the table that God places before God's enemies. Never lose sight of the fact, my brothers and sisters, that this is God's battle. Good Friday is about God. It's God's time. Stand back and see. Learn to wait. Do not be anxious. Do not be troubled. God's got this. Let's remember. God's got this. Just in case you miss it, God's got it. God knows what God is doing. You can't do a better job. Try as hard as you may, you can't do a better job. God knows what God's doing. God's got this. So, as the fellows on the street would say, "Lo, God, no." And as some persons here would say, "Lo, God, no." God's got it. So, "Lo, God, let God be God."
And do not try to wrest God's authority
and God's power. God is demonstrating in the act of Good Friday that God's got it. He spreads a table before me, says the psalmist, in the presence of my enemies. But we're not stopping there. Not only do we see the action of God, but we want to see the antics of the enemy. We want to look a little closer at the antics of the enemy. We want to look at what they are doing. The enemy for Jesus represented all those who did not believe in him or accepted what he came to do. People had different reactions to Jesus' death on Good Friday. Some of us are still reacting to that experience. Some of us couldn't care that it happened. Some of us care a little. Some of us say, it is good that it happened for other people, but it hasn't happened for me. Nothing has happened for me, but it has happened for other people. We may be at different points in how we understand. But they were the enemies, and we see their antics. Who are these enemies? They were the religious leaders. They didn't think that they were enemies doing. Like the high priest, who saw Jesus as a threat to Orthodox religion. What was Jesus doing? How can you go about telling people to love their enemies? That's not what we do here. How can you go about telling people to violate the Sabbath by telling a man to take up his bed and walk? We don't do that kind of thing. Orthodox religion don't do that kind of thing. How can you tell people to pay taxes to Caesar? That's not correct. They have to pay taxes into the temple treasury. How can you agree with the oppressive Roman power who claim that Jesus is the Son of God? But the religious leaders were aided and abetted by an insider, one of Jesus' own disciples, Judas. We all know this and we have heard this story already. Sometimes the enemy can't get close to the target. The enemy can't get close to the one they want to destroy. Sometimes they have to go to an insider, a close friend. Read Psalm 55, where David talks more about what happened. David talks more about my familiar friend, my companions, those who walk with me, those who wait with me, my companions. They find themselves in that kind of situation where they come alongside the one that they intend to hurt and destroy. Who was overwhelmed by the sorrowful nature of his transaction on the discovery that he had overplayed his hand. That's what Judas realized. The enemy represented the Roman leaders, although Jesus was not so much concerned about them, but about his own people who placed him on their hands, or who placed him in their hands. The enemy were the soldiers who mocked Jesus and who seemed to have gotten a kick out of ridiculing this Jewish man who claimed that he was their king. So the enemies were about doing their thing. They didn't. They weren't concerned, rather, about Jesus. They weren't concerned about honoring God. They weren't concerned even about following Jewish religion. They were concerned about their own interests and themselves. But you know, there's another enemy that we miss in this passage. There's another enemy that we miss in our lives. There's another enemy that had to be, that Jesus had to encounter. You know which enemy that is? The enemy of the self. The stubborn will. The stubborn self. The carnal mind. The impulsive nature. The penchant to go our own way. The
disciples.
He encountered with some of his own people. That enemy.
Sometimes Paul picks this up when he says, listen, sometimes the wrestling we have is not against flesh and blood.
It's not against external enemies either. It's about spiritualities and powers, principalities and powers. It's about those forces that are outside, and they are also those forces that are within.
The antics of the enemy included shaving. You know, shaving was a part of that society. It included rejection and ridicule, as well as claiming ascendancy and success. As far as they were concerned, they were successful. They got Pilate to change his mind. Release unto us Barabbas. Pilate agonized, but Pilate didn't have the will to say, let me release Jesus to you because he's innocent. You see sometimes where the enemy is? They knew the enemies. They knew what cards to play. They knew what they were to respond to. They knew what they could do.
They knew how they could influence. Sometimes the enemy may claim success and ascendancy. It's important to know that they thought they were doing the right noble thing to kill this imposter and to crush the movement. John 12. You will note that they had plotted to kill Lazarus. John 12 verse 9. They had plotted to kill Lazarus as well, because Lazarus was living evidence of the power of Jesus. Lazarus stood before them as a man who was raised from the dead by Jesus. And so, because of Lazarus, there are people who are following Jesus. There are people who have joined this movement, this Jesus movement. And so they were going to kill Lazarus. Because if they kill Lazarus, they would have squashed the movement. Not knowing that you can't squash what God has created. You can't crush an experience or a movement. It's their own misreading of the reality of the work and ministry of Jesus. They did not have a clue what Jesus, what God was doing, and what God was working through Jesus.
Why did they not believe?
They also seem to have misread their own capacity to silence the Son of God. Did they know who they were up against? Jesus came to his own people, and his own people received him not. He came to his own people, and his own people received him.
So it is the reality of our own lives, my brothers and sisters. Our enemies are totally unaware of what they are up against. Their attempts to attack, to malign, to destroy those who would follow in the kingdom of God, realize that it's an exercise in futility.
When the believer is told to put on the whole armor of God, you're reminded that the enemy cannot touch you when you have on the whole armor. The breastplate of righteousness. When there are those parts of the armor of prayer, there is a sword which is the word of God. When you are empowered by the armor, you can face any situation. But I want us to remember that the enemy has a clear agenda. And we must never underestimate what the enemy intends to do. They are going to pursue and pursue and pursue until they achieve their objective. The enemy does not take breaks. The enemy works overtime. And there's always somebody, if they take a break, there's always somebody to continue the shift. So there's never a dull period over any time at all. They do not sleep. There is no slumber. The enemy's intention is to steal, to kill, and to destroy. The metaphors that are used of the enemy is to terrorize, is to torment. It's like a roaring lion, and it's a hungry roaring lion. It's not just any lion, it's a hungry one. And a hungry one that wants
food.
When you get this picture, you understand that the enemy has an agenda. And so all of these people were stacked against Jesus on Good Friday, leading up to that time. They had one intention. They would not have heard anything else. They were going to destroy Jesus. They were going to destroy this movement. They could not accept the teaching that Jesus offered, or accept that Jesus was the Son of God and that he had come with a distinct mission, and that mission was to liberate them. They were going to kill the liberator. They were going to sacrifice the deliverer. The deliverer, because that was their intention. So the contrivance of the enemy are too short and too weak for the divine intention. Try as they may. They are too impotent to frustrate God's intentions and pleasure. What I bound on earth shall be, what is bound on earth shall be bound in heaven. What is bound on earth shall be bound, and what is loose on earth shall be loose. You get the picture? There's nothing that could change that. Evil men exist. But men are men, and God is God.
Amen.
God declares that God's people are the generation or the object of God's care, God's compassion, and God's grace. Though living in the midst of deadly enemies. We live in the midst of enemies, but God is God. I wonder how much we see this in our lives, friends. I wonder how much stories and experience we have that every day, sometimes it will happen to make trouble. It just run at you. It just pursue you. You don't have to say anything to anybody. It just seems like trouble walking around you, walking beside you, waiting to pounce on you. Trouble seems to be when you get up in the morning, when you go to bed at night, when you walk to work or drive to work, wherever it is, your whole life seems to be surrounded by the enemy. How do you function in all of this? Believers need to remember that we live in victory. That's what the Good Friday message is all about. Therefore, the believer does not have to fear. The enemy can do all they want. They see and they envy and they fret at what they see, but they cannot hinder it. Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Yes.
They can look at it, they see what is happening. They hear what is happening. They envy what God is doing. They fret. But they can't change it. They can't hinder it. No, they cannot hinder God's plan to deliver, protect, and liberate God's sheep. I wonder if we believe this.
Yes.
I wonder if we know our position in Christ. So while we live in the midst of enemies, there is a posture, there is an attitude, there is a position we take, that we know that we live in victory.
Hallelujah.
That is what is demonstrated by Christ in Good Friday. That although the enemies came at him, although the enemies attacked him, although he cried out to the Father from the cross, he experienced the loneliness in journeying that path. My God, why have you forsaken me? The emptiness of the soul, the darkness of the soul, the agony of the soul, the sorrowful nature of the soul, Jesus faced as a consequence of making the choice to stand up and to die for you and for me.
Amen.
That's the path Jesus took. And I want you to know, while Jesus stood on the cross,
he was perfect man and he was perfect God.
Hallelujah.
God the Father could not have, through his compassionate love, through his abiding love, through his constraining love, he had to allow that to happen to his Son and to himself as well, and to God's self. Because that was the extent of which God would redeem humanity. Brothers and sisters, I want to move to the third observation. We see the action of God, the antics of the enemies. Don't we want to look at the attitude of the shepherd in the presence of his enemies? In the presence of my enemies. in the presence of my enemies. The enemies surround you. The enemies are around. The enemies are coming at you. And they have one intention. What do you do? Usually people say that when trouble coming after you, when trouble take you, what they say happen? Take a short video. All kind of things happen. And we say in another way that when trouble is coming, you either freeze, you fight, or there is flight. So it's one of those three F's. You freeze, I know you have some bugs that do that. They just curl up or they go under their shell, and you just can't know what is happening. You knock as hard as you can, but they just freeze. They just hear one place. You have some who run as fast as they can, and you have some who take advantage position. Boy, we might fight to the bitter end. This is the story of a shepherd in a particular community, in Palestinian community, who was attacked by some others, and he fought and fought for a sheep. He was eventually overcome by those by his attackers, but he fought to the bitter end to protect his sheep. What is the attitude that he displayed in this situation? What is the attitude that the shepherd displayed? That the shepherd who became the Lamb of God, and what can we learn from his attitude? The shepherd who appeared as a sheep was completely surrendered to his enemy. The shepherd that appeared as a sheep was completely surrendered to his enemy. But I want you to understand. Although Jesus surrendered, it was so much the enemy Jesus was surrendering to. Jesus was surrendering to the Father. He was surrendering his will to the Father. He displayed complete confidence and assurance in the host who had spread the table. The table was spread before the enemies. It has been noticed that when a soldier is in battle, he may eat, but if he does, he grabs a bite and runs. Don't you find that sometimes? You run home for lunch, you don't have time to sit down and have a meal. You just grab something. Or sometimes while you're driving, you stop somewhere and get something and you're on the move because you're on the job. You don't have time to sit down for a godly meal. Listen, this is how Jesus puts it. He says, this is how the psalmist puts it. He said he spreads a table in the presence of your enemies. Now can you imagine, you are in the battle line. You are in the front of the battle. And imagine somebody come out and spread a table. Let's get the picture. Yeah. This is war. This is a war zone. Shatter fire. Shatter fire all over the place. And somebody said, okay, what's that again? Oh, those are some shots? Okay, time for me to lay the table. Time for me to put the goodies on it. So I can sit down and enjoy my meal. Time for me to have my three-course or my five-course meal without interruption. I am not concerned about what I'm doing. He spreads a table in the presence of my enemies. Understand what the shepherd is saying that God is doing. He spreads a table before in the presence of the enemies. So what is the shepherd supposed to do? What David does? David understands the picture is different. The host spreads up the cloth, lays the meal, removes the covering, and reveals all that there is for the soldier to eat in the presence of the enemies. Nothing is hurried. There is no confusion. There is no checking the phone or the watches. No disturbance or distraction. The enemy is there at the door looking on. But the believer sits down and eats as if it is perfect peace. The enemy can rant and rave, but I will not be fazed by their antics. What confidence. Amen. What assurance. Because it is God who prepares the table. It is God who is in charge. So the enemies can rave up, and sometimes you get frightened because the enemy looks like they have great firepower. The enemy looks like they have it. What the enemy may have, what contradicts what you have, but they don't have the power that God has.
Amen.
It's important to know that. It was liberating and in joy before the Lamb. So that when Pilate asked, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus said, "Well," so they said, "Are you the King of the Jews? You know I have the power to give you life and even to take it away." Jesus said, "Really? You have that power? So you might think." I'm paraphrasing. "But you have that power, so you might think. You don't have the power to do anything here."
Amen.
"You don't have the power to do anything here." You see? So the enemy may think that they are in control. But when the Lord spreads the table, that's an indication of who runs things in this yard.
Amen.
Of who runs things in this joint. Of who runs things in this spot.
Yes. That is what was being conveyed by in the presence of my enemies.
The attitude of the shepherd is one in which he displayed peace and wholeness in the face of violence. By his posture, the shepherd was saying that it was possible to live a life of satisfaction and fulfillment despite the presence of the enemies. I wonder how many of us feel that way. I remember picking up the words, some of the words, and I'm not going to read all of them because I don't even know this artist. But you probably know the artist, they're called Charlie Dapp. Some of you may know, but he makes a statement, some of them are going to tell you, "Life my way, and all a set of people to hate me. But look, I just know we are still around. Them are tired, them are tired, them are tired. God love we are ready. So uno, get cut off, them are tired." And you know the song by Bob Marley, the one say, "You're tired, this is the face. Can't get me out of the race. Oh man, you said I'm in your place." And then you draw that card, and then you draw that card, and then you draw that card. But you are tired. You are tired. This is the place. My brothers and sisters, the point is, in the words of these artists, they are expressing triumph. They are expressing defiance. They are saying it doesn't matter what the enemy does, the enemy cannot prevail. And that is the confidence we have in facing life. That is what we are reminded on Good Friday. Good Friday reminds us
that God is in control.
So I end with this. How are you going to make all of this applicable in your life? We're going to make it happen. When we go through suffering, let me suggest, do not focus on what the enemy is doing. Because that's where we tend to begin. We tend to look at what the enemy is doing. Don't waste energy on that. When you do that, you're going to get angry. You're going to want to take revenge. You're going to want to cry out injustice. We want justice. When you focus on the enemy. Don't focus on the enemy. That's going to distract you. You will feel overwhelmed by anger. Instead, look. And then, if you have to look at them with pity. You heard Jesus said while he was on the cross, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do."
If there was any anger in that heart, if there was any anger in that soul, he couldn't ask for their forgiveness. So don't focus on them. With compassion, you are to look at them, that they may know what they do. Don't think that they want to kill you off. Don't think that they are evil and malicious and unjust and mean. No. Think that they are agents of Satan. That they are servants in the hands of the enemy. But what you are facing is your feast table God has prepared for you. Hallelujah. Amen. Their power is limited. Even if they take your life, they do not have the last word. That's what you need to remember. That they can take away everything. They can take even your life. But they do not have the last word. There is a peace the believer feels when you know that God is in charge. Look at Peter, beaten and placed in jail. Look how sweetly he slept. Not a place to relish, but Peter could sleep there. Fastened between two soldiers.
not the most comfortable of position. And the night before, Herod was going to execute him, yet he slept like a baby. All this is recorded in Acts chapter 12, verse 6 and 7. This was after James was killed, Peter arrested with intention of facing the same fate as James. But I ask, where was Peter's mind while he was going through this experience? Where was Peter's spirit while he was going through this experience? Where was his soul while he was going through this experience? It so happened that the angel sent to give him his jail deliverance
had to slap him on the cheek.
Wake up! I think she was sleeping that night. Sister Dawn was sleeping. Had to slap him on the cheek and say, wake up! Peter was fast asleep. No, what am I getting at? This man, this disciple, was arrested to be killed. He was thrown in jail. And while in jail, he could sleep like a baby. Can you imagine? Which of you know that you have a trial to face tomorrow if you have seen the night before? Which of you have some stressful decision to face in the day and you can't get enough rest the night before? Which of you have some deadlines to meet tomorrow and feel you can't get all the sleep you want to get the night before? I know that you can, but I can't do it so well.
So well.
Even if I try. But yet, why is it that Peter was able to do this? He knew he was in control. In the presence of my enemies, I know that God has me. And because God has me, I can display an attitude that is contrary to what others may think I should be displaying. Others think that this is how you should be behaving in this context. But he was at peace. Unruffled, he was at peace, unmoved, untroubled, because he knew God was with him.
You know, I had an experience recently where in part of my encounter with someone who raised a question of me, and the person by raising the question or presented made a suggestion, I would say. And later, the suggestion became an action. And I thought that the particular suggestion was only a suggestion that we would have debated and we would have discussed.
Later, realized that the suggestion was an action or something that was implemented and was acted on. Can you imagine how I felt in that situation? Moving from waiting for a discussion to discover it is already done.
Everything in me said, how could he?
How could this person act in this way? How could he function? This is ungodly. This is unchristian. This is unrighteous. And while I was getting on, it's like a piece that came over me. Trevor, hold it. Hold it. Just relax. Oh, that's exactly what they want. That's exactly what they want you to do. They want you to find all the reasons to show that they have acted in an unjust, unfair, unreasonable way, and for you to say, and for you to tell the world that this is what has happened. Relax. Take the approach that Jesus took. He opened his mouth like a lamb before the shearer. He was silent. And this is what a lamb does. A lamb is led, a lamb remains calm, a lamb is in control, because a lamb knows
what the shepherd is going to do.
The shepherd is shearing, so the lamb remains calm as the shepherd is shearing.
My brothers and sisters, I wonder that night if Herod had any sleep when he knew what he was going to do with Peter. But Peter could sleep, because Peter knew that whether he was here or not here, he was still going to be closer to the Lord. In the presence of my enemies, it is here that God is at God's best. You want to tweet that? In the presence of my enemies.
enemies. It is there that God is at God's best. It is there that God takes charge.
In the presence of thy enemies.
It is there that the enemy goes deeper in the bag and comes up with the worst punishment. In the presence of my enemies. The enemy is going for the jugular. The enemy is going and not going to leave any stone unturned until he achieves what he or she wants to achieve in your life.
Yes. Where the enemy tears into your soul to break your spirit and your will as they tried with Jesus.
They did everything to hear Jesus relent. And even in the end, they couldn't take Jesus' life. He gave it up himself. He says, Father, into your hands, I commit my spirit. They tried to numb the pain by giving him aloe and myrrh to numb the pain. Jesus said, no, you know what? None of that. I need to feel this to the bitter end.
They tried to weaken his resolve, to insist that he give up on God and change his mind. People around you, the enemies will try to do that. The enemies will attack you from every single source. They'll attack you from within your family. They'll attack you outside your family. They'll attack you in the church. They'll attack you outside the church. They'll attack you everywhere. Just remember, all of these attempts are to break your will. But my brothers and sisters, don't lose sight of the fact that God is with you in the presence of your enemies. Even if they seek to weaken your resolve and to insist that you give up on God and to change your mind, it is at that point that God, that the good old gospel song encourages the saints. And you know this song, press along, saints, press along. In God's own way. Press along, saints, press along. In God's own way. Press along, saints, press along. In God's own way. Persecution we must bear. Trials and crosses in our way. For the hotter the battle, the sweeter the victory.
Yes, the hotter the battle,
the sweeter the victory. The believer is not alone. Put on your courage. Put on your confidence.
For God is with you.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Singing of the hymn, the Lord's my shepherd, I am a boy.
Thank you. getting towards the close of this service. We are not finished yet. Today is still Good Friday. And in some of the tradition, people start the vigil from the night before. And they go right through from 6 to 9, and then 9 to 12, and then 12 to 3. And 3 o'clock is the last watch where Jesus said, "Into your hands I commit my spirit." We hope that you can carry with us for the time you're here. Part of the reason of incorporating the Lord's Supper in this service, which again in some tradition would be observed on Holy Thursday, the night before, and also an act of washing, which is done at that time. We are observing the Lord's Supper today. But I want us to, even if we may not participate, I want us all to remain and go through the end of the service and share this act. Use it as a moment of prayerful reflection for yourself as you focus not on the person beside you who may be partaking if you are not, but focus on the fact that this is the body of Christ broken. It is the blood of Christ shed on Good Friday. And we have an opportunity to share in our intimate way in this experience. When we invite you so to do, at the end of the communion, the secretary will just share with us any brief announcements or general welcome to those who have come, and then we will have the final act of reading and final act of reading and singing before we go. I'm going to ask that we remain as we move, we transition right away into the great holy communion. No amount of ridicule or rejection could prevent him from offering all for those who are behind those jeers and those statements of ridicule. We thank you, O God, for the gracious attitude of Jesus Christ, who has left for us an example that we should follow in his steps. We thank you that Jesus has left not only the example, but has given us his spirit, so that, being empowered by that spirit, we too can face our enemies with confidence and courage, knowing that you are with us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And so we just want to ask, O God, that you will be present with those in a special way who are not here today, particularly our members who are homebound. They have been missed sharing in this fellowship. May they, where they are, be touched by your grace. Be touched by your presence and feel again the grace outpoured for them, the compassion and love that enfolds them, that they are not rejected or abandoned, but you are with them. May they know that you spread a table before your enemies. And they remain in your presence. Hear us, Lord, as we pray. In Jesus' name. Amen. We invite our secretary at this time to just share. We've heard of welcome and
welcome. We should take it away, sin of this world. A very special welcome to every worshiper this morning here at Battleford Baptist Church on this blessed Good Friday morning. We trust that you have been blessed so far by the worship experience, and that indeed you are especially conscious of the grace of God. goodness to all of us. And so, we say a special welcome to our pastor, Reverend Edwards, to Sister Sharon Edwards, and to all who read so beautifully this morning. It has truly been a good experience. A very special welcome to our first-time visitors. And I have two cards. Daphne Hay, and Daphne is the sister of Sister Malcolm. Good to have you with us this morning. We also have Shay Brewster, and Shay is from University of the West Indies. Good to have you both with us this morning. Brothers and sisters, can we just sing our usual welcome song? Have better study on Wednesday evening, and we certainly invite you to come out. Shay, invite you to come out as well on Wednesday evening for a better study. And of course, for our usual Easter Sunday service, which will be at 8 o'clock on Sunday. And so, brothers and sisters, visitors and friends, we ask as usual that you remember in your prayers the homebound. We ask that you remember the sick. We ask that you just look to see who is not in church today and reach out to them if you can and to bear them up in your prayers. We ask especially that you bear in your prayers our sisters who are not well, and we have been naming them one by one. You know Sister June Dunkley, Sister Angela Distant, Sister Romelda Clark, and we ask that you truly, truly put them in your prayers. God is good, and if you believe that he's a great physician, he will take care of our dear sisters. If it is his will. We ask that you... We have a card here from Sister Princess Robinson and Sister Latoya. You remember they're on the past on a few weeks ago, and so as usual, the Barbican Baptist Church family rally around our members when something happens, and so they're just trying to say thanks to the church family. They're thankful for our prayers, for our calls, for our visits, our words of kindness as they dealt with the loss of their dear uncle Clinton. But this card is from the family. For the notices, as I said earlier, we'll have our regular Easter Sunday worship service, 8 o'clock on Sunday morning. We expect to see everyone out, and invite a friend, invite a neighbor, because then we're going to celebrate the risen Christ. Yes. Yeah. On Wednesday evenings, we want to remind you again to come out and join the Bible study class. It is just absolutely enlightening. Wednesday just passed, we spent some time just looking at the prayers that Jesus did in the Garden of Gethsemane. And it's amazing the amount of insights, the amount of information that you get just by sharing in the Bible study sessions. So please come on this Wednesday and be a part of the group. You will be blessed by the experience and you'll always want to come back. Wednesday at 7, as usual, we start with prayers at 6:30, and we get into Bible study at 7 p.m. On Sunday, 23rd of April, We told you last week we're going to have visitors from the King's House Avenue Citizens Association. We won't have them anymore. They will come another time. Instead, we are going to have a visit from Calabar High School. We don't think we'll have a crowd as the last time, but we're not sure if the numbers are there. But we'll tell you, you'll hear soon enough. And as usual, we will welcome them, eh? Yes, because now we have celebrated with them, and we're still celebrating with Calabar High School on their championship at the victory at Boys Champion, a few weeks ago. They just want to come and say thanks to us, eh? Because clearly we helped them into that victory, didn't we? yes, we did. On the 23rd also, will be this Sunday when some of our members go to visit the Richmond Hill Baptist Church. And as we said before, we ask that you just let Sister Elliot know, Deacon Elliot, if you can be a part of that group. But we want to have persons here, right? Because Calabar is coming, eh? Yeah. All right. On Monday the 24th, council members remember, we're going to have a special council meeting starting at 6:30. And we really, really need every council member to be in attendance on Monday, April 24th. And we told you before that on Sunday, April 30th, will be our quarterly members meeting. This starts right after church. We get best attendance when we have the meetings after church. And so we ask that everybody remain on April 30th. That's the last Sunday of the month. Please remain behind to be a part of the quarterly members meeting. That is the quarter ending, the second quarter. End of the second quarter. That's the meeting, but it's a little late, but please come out for that meeting. We want to also remind you that Sunday evening at 6, Easter Sunday evening, April 16th at 6 p.m., you will please come and join us for the Easter story. And tickets are around. You can ask anyone of the choir members for your tickets. It's only $600. And I'm sure the blessings will far, far, far surpass $600. So please come on out and support the Barbican Baptist Church in a choir in association with East King Street Baptist Church in a choir of Menteith. We also have a new activity coming up. We're just saying it briefly before we're going to ask Sister Rochelle to get a flyer to go on the notice board. This is Reverend Chef, and so it will be a cooking competition among pastors, and it's going to happen on May 6th, starting at 11 o'clock at United Theological College, 7 Golden Avenue. And you'll hear more about it. That's just to tell you it's coming up. You'll see the flyer, and there are tickets at Boulevard Baptist, Bethel Baptist, Ebonyville Baptist, Mona Baptist, Virgin Baptist, and the JBU Bookstore. So that is coming. You'll hear more about it. I don't know if Reverend Edward is going to be a part of it. I hope so. And just remind you, finally, that the healing ministry team is asking us to make donations towards the Healing Weekend. The activity that they have is the Homestead Place of Safety, and they're asking for cash or kind. It's a girls' home, and so whatever you know, toiletries and so forth will be welcome. And you can speak with, if it's cash, you can speak with Sister Delos Montague, Sister Colleen Morrison, or Deacon Livermore. The box is in the education building. And we ask that you remember, we try to share, we try to give. And finally, to say that on May 7th, there will be a prayer and praise night. And we start at 6:30 until 9 p.m. And it will be here at Barbican Baptist. The church will be meeting to pray for biological families on the theme, healing the nation, one family at a time. Healing the nation, one family at a time. That will be May 7th, starting at 6:30 p.m. And we'll hear more about this, of course, as we get closer to that date. May God bless you all.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Madam Secretary. While the when you do this all quietly in Brethren, the ushers are going to come and they are going to receive your offering. See this offering as part of the offering you make. Please just go ahead. You'll say the prayers after. Just go ahead. Please see this offering as part of the offering you're making. A sacrificial offering, even as Jesus offered himself, that you are making a part of what God has blessed you with to give to the Lord. While the offering is being received, I just want to acknowledge in the welcome presence of Carrie and Seanel Drake. Welcome, we want to ask them to stand. They are sitting on over there, all the way from Switzerland. They are worshiping with us today. And we're happy to see you both. It was quite a surprise when I looked across and saw them. They are here to celebrate Seanel's father's, I think, 75th part of that something. Not supposed to say anything about that yet, but okay. The church, you didn't hear anything? Shh, please. You didn't hear anything at all about that. But we are happy to see them, and we are happy to know that they can find the time or be able to make the time to share in this way, in this at this time of the year. So welcome, Seanel and Carrie. And after the offering, we have one closing act that we are going to share in. We go out in confidence, anticipating Sunday's renewal. And as soon as the ushers return with the offering, we'll close with this section with the offering through prayer, and then we will have that reading and our closing song.
Sunday's renewal. The reading from Revelation chapter 5 from verse 6 to 14, and I'm reading from the NKJV version. And I looked, and behold, in the midst of the throne and of the four living creatures, and in the midst of the elders, stood a lamb as though it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. Then he came and took the scroll out of the right hand of him who sat on the throne. Now when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each having a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, "You are worthy to take the scroll and to open the seals, for you were slain and have redeemed us to God by your blood, out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation, and have made us kings and priests to our God, and we shall reign on the earth." Then I looked, and I heard the voice of many angels around the throne, the living creatures and the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power
and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. And every creature which is in heaven and on earth and on the earth and under the earth, and such as are in the sea and all that are in them, I heard saying, blessing and honor and glory and power be to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb forever and ever. Then the four living creatures said, Amen. And the 24 elders fell down and worshipped him who lives forever and ever. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Anticipating Sunday's renewal. Brothers and sisters, let us pause for a moment. Just give thanks for the offering that was received. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have given us the opportunity to give back some of that which you have blessed us with. And as we give in the spirit of sacrifice, from a heart of thanksgiving, with gratefulness, we pray, Heavenly Father, you receive it. We ask that you would use it, enable it to be used for the furthering of your kingdom, the establishment of your kingdom here on this earth. We pray, Heavenly Father, that you would receive it from our hands, and we pray that your blessings will continually rest on your people. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
The closing hymn, there's a slight edit on the program, has been replaced with Why Should He Love Me So? It will be displayed on the screen, and the singers and players of instruments have been appropriately prepared. So the closing hymn, Why Should He Love Me So? Love sent my Savior to die in my stead.
Thank you.
silence, as you would have observed on the order of worship, moment of silence after I finish with this night. And then we will lead and we'll take the candle which represents the light that still shines, the life of Christ that still shines. And don't have Uncle Doug will be able to get some bells from the there, there. So we will hear the bells tolling when we get down there. So we will pause for the silence as we put our thoughts together, coming to the end of this service, and then we will recess.
So God who liberates, God who redeems, God who sets us free, grant you today and may each of us, through his grace, his mercy, and the richness of his love, embrace all that he has done for us. In the name of Christ our Lord. Bells.
Amen.